Designer drug products are killing and crippling consumers all over the U.S. Typically, they have a way that they do that. There's certain steps they take. First, the industry capitalizes on direct-to-consumer advertising laws that are only legal, by the way, in the United States and Australia. With direct-to-consumer advertising, you often see drug companies creating a need for a drug by going as far as creating a new disease. They do that year in, year out. Turn on your TV. You'll see drugs being hustled for everything ranging from restless feet to restless eyeballs. Feeling old? Will take testosterone gel. Feeling like an underperformer? Try Viagra. Feeling sad, mad, or overly glad? Pop a pink pill or two. You'll feel better. The first step for any accomplished drug hustler is to create the need with an endless advertising blitz. Most of the time, the story doesn't end well for consumers who are told that they're too stressed, they're too fat, they're too sad, and they're too sleep deprived. Step two for the drug company hustlers is to promise a dysfunctional, completely dysfunctional FDA that the clinical trials conducted by them for their magic pill is truthful and that they're accurate. They have to tell the FDA that the need for their new drug is so overwhelming that there's no time to delay. Consumers need the drugs and they need them now. Because of that, the rush to the market and the FDA allow almost daily phonied up clinical trials and lack of testing to become the norm with drug oversight. That's the world you're living in. And if someone inside the FDA actually shows some honesty by asking tough questions about the drug industry, well, then the industry unleashes their holy war on that individually simply by calling a few trick monkey congressmen to handle the troublemaker. The same holds true with doctors who become critics after they finally realize that the new wonder drug is killing their patients. They see their hospital privileges revoked. They're often harassed, embarrassed, and discredited by their peers who are owned and operated by the drug industry. We call them biostitutes, and we're going to talk about that tonight. But maybe the most important step in selling useless drugs is to make certain that corporate media is paid so much drug advertising money that they fail to report that drugs are crippling and killing consumers. Big money talks with the corporate media, and that is the rule. Today, you live in a dangerous world where it comes to big marketing pharmaceuticals. Many times, even your treating doctor isn't aware of manipulated clinical data about the dangers of drugs that they prescribe. They assume, and consumers believe, that if it's on the market, well, certainly the FDA has done their job. Certainly the FDA has looked at all this. Well, the next time you're prescribed a drug, go home and research it through social media, through blogs, through chat rooms and advocacy sites. And you're going to learn more about that drug than you're ever going to learn from the FDA or the manufacturers, because the truth is neither one of them is doing their job. Joining me to talk more about this is David Haynes. He's a consumer lawyer. He's a pharmaceutical specialist with the Cochran firm right here in Washington, D.C. David, thank you for joining me. The frenzy for the new drug scams, they're just almost overwhelming, aren't they?
And Big Pharma is creating the frenzy. They're creating it themselves through the sheer weight of their financial firepower. As you said, they're creating the market and the desire through slick advertising in the hundreds of millions of dollars. The doctors are having a situation where the consumer is actually coming in asking to be prescribed the drug.
Well, that's the effect of direct. It used to be a doctor would prescribe the drug. Now they see it on all day long, advertisements. You need this, you got the sniffles, you got a headache, you know, restless feet. Go tell your doctor that you want a new drug. Isn't that how it works? I mean, the statistics are overwhelming, aren't they?
It's exactly right. I mean, millions of dollars are being paid on the advertising, and also, of course, the pharmaceutical companies are essentially buying doctors to support their clinical research and to convince other doctors as well that these drugs are needed. These are often drugs that, these are not new drugs, they're often Me Too drugs. They're not a new cure for a fatal disease. These are often just a slight tweak, and the pharmaceutical company has to create the need. So the drugs which are truly novel and innovative, those drugs are selling themselves.
David, you've kind of become an expert in the area of what I call the atrial fib drugs. First of all, explain how ugly that story is. I mean, the people listening to this probably won't believe it, but explain how ugly that story is, where the pharmaceutical industry came in with this baby boomer thing of everybody's going to die of atrial fibs. Let's go sell drugs.
Yeah, it really has been a phenomenon. We're seeing certainly concerns with Xarelto and Eliquis, other drugs in the market as well in this situation where they're creating the market and they're having fatal complications as a result, when really there are perfectly suitable drugs which have time-tested, have been on the market for decades, and these new me-too drugs are coming out and the pharmaceutical company is trying to convince the consumer that their drug is somehow better.
Well, first of all, if you look at the history of all these drugs, they all knew that the clinical data was bunk. It was completely, most of it on all of these atrial fib drugs, it was gamed in such a way to where it looks like the American public needs it. But if you take a look, you had Coumadin forever. I mean, you have drugs that have been on the market for 60 years that have worked just fine, but all of a sudden the baby boomer generation comes along, atrial fib's a problem, and so they come in and they say, wow, this is going to be a cash bonanza for us, so we're going to take shortcuts on our clinicals, we're going to sell this drug as a designer drug. Isn't that kind of what happened?
It's absolutely what happened. As you said in the opening, the consumer believes that, well, the FDA must have reviewed all of this data and it must be okay, but of course the FDA can't keep up. With these issues, and the pharmaceutical company is such a huge supporter. You have a revolving door at FDA. You have the doctors that are on the hook. You have a number of these companies that are paying tens of millions of dollars to doctors for essentially what are kickbacks to support and go around on the speaking circuit that these drugs are needed to back up the direct-to-consumer marketing that we're seeing, that we allow in this country.
Yeah, something you wrote about one time, I think it was $19 million that has been put into trying to get doctors, just by the atrial fib business, trying to get doctors to use these blood clotting drugs. I mean, these drugs that are supposed to save them from atrial fib. But the truth is, people are bleeding to death from products like Xarelto. That's the ugly side of the story.
Horrible, horrible hemorrhaging deaths, terrible outcomes when Coumadin or warfarin is a perfectly acceptable, safer alternative, yet these pharmaceutical companies, the bottom line, they're trying to drive up the stock price. The CEO is there for a matter of a couple of years. Drive it up as high as you can. Don't worry about patient safety. The CEO flies out the back door, parachuting out with a package of tens of millions of dollars, leaving patient deaths and injuries in his wake without seemingly caring about the repercussions.
And we think, don't we, that the FDA is in control of that, don't we? Well, I mean, we really do believe. If you go out on the street and you ask 10 people, does the FDA test drugs? All of them will say yes. And the truth is, they do not test drugs. People believe that, though. They believe the FDA is, surely it's safe because the FDA looked at it. The FDA doesn't even look at the drugs. They take the word of the pharmaceutical company.
It really is more of a reactionary agency. And so after the fact, you know, and then you see drug recalls and you wonder how the drug ever got on the market in the first place. You're right. The testing is not there. And often it's too late that the FDA then will actually take action. And you or a loved one might have been injured.
Well, right now, for example, we're going to see the new trend I think you're going to see is with diabetes drugs. We already saw one phase with diabetes drugs where every week there was some new drug. There's this thing, what is it, Victoza?
Victoza is another one of these me-too drugs for diabetics. With concern about the blood sugar, but there's a very concerning link to thyroid cancer, which is being developed and being studied. But of course, the consumer doesn't know about that.
Okay, but isn't the goal for a company like the people making Victoza? They simply want to keep it on the market as long as they can. In other words, they know at some day the chickens are going to come home to roost. They know nobody's going to go to prison. They know that they're killing people. They know it's such reckless conduct that people are dying. But they say, keep it on the market because we're making $4 billion a year. We can do that for 10 years. We can pay out $1 billion to people who die. And then you know what? We've made a lot of money. Isn't that kind of mentality right now?
Unfortunately, it is a very cold clinical cash analysis, as seen as just really a cost of doing business. Keep it out there. A lot of these drugs for some of these companies, one or two drugs, make up a tremendous portion of their market capitalization. They can't afford to have these drugs withdrawn. They're really the cash cows. So they're going going to turn a blind eye to what they know is the reality of the medicine.
There's some out there called guinea pig medicine right now, and that is where the clinicals really don't show that the drug is safe, but the FDA allows it to go onto the market anyway, and the way they test it is to use you and people watching this program as guinea pigs. They'll look at the data a year later and say, oh my God, you know, we thought we were right, we thought the clinical data was accurate, but I guess we were wrong. Sorry your grandma died, sorry your mother died, or your brother and your sister died. But you know what? To them, they still make that $1 billion, and it's business as usual, isn't it?
It really is. And so to your viewers out there, they really should be looking at these Me Too drugs that are coming out and think about, this is a new drug on the market. Is it really better? Are there safety concerns that might be coming out in the future? Am I better sticking with Coumadin or Warfarin, which is time-tested?
Ten years. If it's not out there 10 years, I tell you, don't use it. Go investigate it. Go to social media. That's where you'll learn everything.